9:23 on Friday evening, there was a drive-by at the school. Within minutes, my neighborhood was filled with the sounds of sirens rushing to and fro. A helicopter was circling overhead. Before long, my phone was blowing up with text messages and Facebook messages. There were rumors and posts on Facebook. "The coroner's van is there," one person said. "This used to be a nice town," somebody else said. "I'm moving to Utah," said a third. For those who don't already know, at the time those wild rumors were flying around Facebook, the Selma Fire Department paramedics were on scene, but no coroner's van. No one was hit by any bullets. Our Selma High School band kids and fans and their parents and football players and everybody from Coalinga High School are all okay. Upset, but okay. At 7:35 Saturday evening, the email came from the Routers, whatever it is, news service. 25 people injured in an explosion in the Chelsea district of Manhattan. That number has risen to 29. A second bomb was found. The New York Police Department is calling it intentional. People on Twitter having no problem whatsoever assigning blame. It's ISIS. It's the Muslims. Kick out all the illegals. But the fact is, no group or individual has yet claimed responsibility. The New York Police Department hasn't yet said anything about who might be responsible. And in fact, just after I finished writing this, the mayor of New York said that it was almost certainly not tied to anything international. May you live in interesting times. Everybody says that this is an ancient Chinese curse. But as is fairly common with things that everybody says, there is absolutely no proof at all of any Chinese source, ancient or modern, existing for this particular saying. It is, however, a potent curse. It is one that seems to have attached itself to this young man pretty permanently. Very much like the character Joe Bissellflick from the Little Abner cartoon, some of you might be old enough to remember, Wizard Rincewind has only to step outside in a peaceful, quiet street to have hordes of barbarians suddenly descend upon whatever city he's in and chase him. He may not have done anything more interesting than have breakfast, but this is what happens to this poor guy all the time. His life is always interesting. He's a character in the Discworld series of books by Terry Pratchett, a British author who I particularly like for his, generous use of puns and wordplay. He writes about a world that is flat and round, hence Discworld. It's carried on the backs of four elephants that are standing on top of a giant tortoise, which is swimming through space. It's a world where insane things might happen because science doesn't exist and logic is not well respected. It's kind of an odd curse when you think about it. Do we want to live in boring times? Really? In times when nothing ever changes, when nothing new or exciting happens, when I wouldn't have an Apple Watch? No new breakthroughs, no inventions, nothing really happening. I mean, I might get annoyed when my phone blows up with all kinds of data flowing in 24/7, but would I want to live in a world when nothing new or different ever occurs? Hardly any of us attract barbarian hordes, after all, or find ourselves escaping from said hordes or some other insane accident on a living piece of luggage, or walk around with a storm cloud over our heads like that Joe Bixel, like whatever his name was, fella in Little Abner. For most of us, unlike these two, life is fairly mundane. For most of us, life is a steady round of routine events broken up by the occasional excitement. One of my friends likens what we do most of the time sort of like being a fireman. You go to work and it's boring, 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 woohoo! Boring, 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 woohoo! Please don't tell any firemen I said that. And when there are terrible things happening, what we get to witness is heroism. We get to see and hear about people who go above and beyond to help, to make positive changes, to reach out to other people and to people who are affected by whatever terrible thing it is that's happened. Sometimes we get to be the ones helping. Now, we've all probably heard it said that this year, this particular election year, is more heated, more divisive, more violent, more nasty than any other election year in the history of the world. That is not actually a true statement. For in the time, at least, of first elections in this country, there have been horrible smear campaigns on both sides from the very beginning. Some of us may be old enough to remember when it only took rumors of a mental health issue leveled against one presidential candidate to lead to his defeat. Andrew Jackson's wife was vilified so horribly in the press and by his opponents that when she died of a sudden massive heart attack in his arms just days before his inauguration, he blamed his opponent for hounding her to death. Abraham Lincoln's opponents were particularly vicious. Not that it kept him from being elected. We've all heard that candidates are told by their campaign managers that they have to go on the attack. They can't be the nice guy, because if they try to do that, they will lose. We've all heard that nice guys finish last. We may all have strong feelings for or against a particular candidate. And none of that matters, because we're told to pray for all of them, for all of those in high places. We are told to pray in thanksgiving and supplication and intercession for all of our leaders, whether we like them or not, whether we agree with them or not, whether we think they're doing the best they can do or not. It's one of those pesky love your neighbor things. Annoying, isn't it? But that's the difficulty that faces us in being Christians. We have to follow that pesky love commandment whether we want to or not. It is not a suggestion. It's a commandment. We have to love our neighbors. All of them. And yes, all means all. Not just the ones we like, not just the ones we agree with, not the ones we find attractive in one way or another. All of them. Interesting times, as we tend to think of them, are the exact opposite of the hope expressed in this passage in 1 Timothy, which is that we might live a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and dignity. Yeah, no. Not in violence, not in anger, not in heated accusations or arguments, not in rumors or wild speculations about coroner's vans where there aren't any, but in godliness and dignity. I think that we can live that way during interesting times. Even when we are surrounded by anger and violence and disagreements and rumors and wild speculations, we can be the voice of reason. We can be the calm, collected, loving people who step in to stop the violence, to bring peace into a situation. We can be the ones who can be depended upon to keep our heads, no matter what is going on around us. Not easy. Not going to promise easy, but we can do it. I think that we, through our determination to live in such a way that Christ's love pours out of us onto everybody that we run into, we can bring godliness and dignity into every situation that we face. For there is one God. There There is also one mediator between God and humankind, Christ Jesus, himself human, who gave himself a ransom for all. This was attested at the right time. And we are his hands and his feet and his mouth. It is through our efforts, our prayers, our actions that the world can truly be saved. It will not be easy, but we have a secret weapon. We have something stronger and more powerful than wealth or weaponry or anger or armies. We have prayer. If we pray for peace, our hearts will be peaceful. If our hearts know peace, then we will project it out from us. If we lift up prayers of gratitude for everything that we have, gratitude will guide our living. If we pray prayers of thanksgiving, even for the things we may not especially like in our lives, for instance, I have been known to be grateful for the flu, because it makes me slow down, and sometimes I forget to do that. If we are thankful for everything that comes into our lives, even the things that we do not especially like, our thanksgiving will bring blessings not just to us, but to everyone around us. We are living in interesting times. May our prayers and our supplications, may our words of thanksgiving and praise, may our desire to love and care for all of our neighbors fill the world with the true love of Christ. Let us pray continually for our leaders, for all of them, lifting our voices in thanksgiving and some godliness and in dignity. In Christ's name, amen.